الحمد لله وكفى ثم الصلاة والسلام على رسول المصطفى وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, our sustainer, our provider. We praise him, we glorify him, we ask for his forgiveness. Inshallah, today we'll be rounding off with our topic on نواقض الإسلام, the things that invalidate one's Islam. And the Sheikh rahimahullah ta'ala, he says in conclusion, وَلَا فَوْقَ فِي جَمِيعِ هَذِهِ النَّوَاقِضِ بَيْنَ الْهَازِلِ وَالْجَادِ وَالْخَائِفِ إِلَّا الْمُكْرَهِ وَكُلُّهَا مِنْ أَعْظَمِ مَا يَكُونُ خَطَرًا وَمِنْ أَكْثَرِ مَا يَكُونُ وُقُوعًا فَيَنْبَغِي لِلْمُسْلِمِ أَنْ يَحْذَرَهَا وَيَخَافَ مِنْهَا عَلَى نَفْسِهِ نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ مُوجِبَاتِ غَضَبِهِ وَأَلِيمِ عِقَابِهِ وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تمت بحمد الله. So this is the conclusion and the rounding part of what the Shaykh is trying to explain to us from the beginning of the class of the nullifier of Islam till the end. So the Shaykh says that وَلَا فَوْقَ فِي جَمِيعِ هَذِهِ النَّوَاقِدْ بَيْنَ الْهَازِلِ وَالْجَادِ وَالْخَائِفِ, that there is no difference with regards to all these nullifiers of Islam. From the first to the tenth nullifier of Islam, they are all the same. In the sense that if one is joking, if one is making fun of any of these nullifiers of Islam, maybe you are playing with it to test something or what, or you are playing, making fun of it, that this one also can also lead on to kufr. Bain al-hazil. Hazil here means you are making fun of it, or you are making jest of it. So this one can lead one to disbelief. I came to understand this because of the act of those munafiq, those hypocrites, in the evidence that we cited earlier before now, that these people were making fun of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions by saying that these people, they love food a lot and they are coward, they cannot face the battle and the likes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala narrated the story to us in Surah At-Tawbah, as we all know, Quran 9 verse 65, where Allah say that وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ لَيَقُولُنَّ إِنَّمَا كُنَّا نَخُوضُ وَنَلْعَبُ قُلْ أَبِ اللَّهِ وَآيَاتِهِ وَرَسُولِهِ كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَهْزِئُونَ. Allah said to them, if these people were to be asked, if you should ask them, لَيَقُولُنَّ إِنَّمَا كُنَّا نَخُونَ الْعَبِ, they will reply that we are just making fun of this, we are just making joke and passing out time, it is nothing, we are just making fun of ourselves and fun of everything. Allah said, قُلْ أَبِ اللَّهِ وَآيَاتِهِ وَرَسُولِهِ كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَهْزِئُونَ. Ask them, Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, ask them, was it Allah, or is it Allah's verse, his verses, his evidences, or his messenger that you are making fun of? Ask them. So this shows that one cannot, if it is issue of the deen, of the religion, one cannot make fun of it. Because it's as if you are making fun of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or his verses, or his messengers. So you are making fun of it, if you are making fun of Allah's religion. So this act can lead one to kufu. And the Shaykh said, well, jad, even if you are serious about it, maybe out of seriousness, you say, la ilaha illam, you say something else, that I believe that Isa, Prophet Isa, is the God, or is the Son of Allah. If you are making fun of it, or you are serious about it, this can lead one to disbelief. If you are serious, or you are making fun of it. Well, khaif, likewise, even if you are afraid, if you are afraid, maybe you are afraid of the disbelievers. If you are afraid of the disbelievers, this can also lead on to kufr. If you are playing with any of the ten nullifiers of Islam because you are afraid of the disbelievers, maybe because of something, so you now say that you believe that Isa is God due to you are being afraid of any of the disbelievers. So this can lead on to disbelief because this is an act of mudahana. As if you are compromising the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to us in Surah Qalam, Quran 68 verse 9, Allah said, what do lau tudihinu fayudihinun? These people, these Christians and the Jews, they wish that you should compromise in the religion. Out of courtesy with them, out of being friendly to them, fayudihinun. And if you do so, they too will also compromise with you. they will compromise with you in the religion. So this is an act of mudahana. It is compromising. So this act is not good. So any of these three things, if it should occur in any of the 10 nullifiers of Islam, it can lead one to disbelief. The Sheikh now brings some exception. He now said, "Illa al-mukrah," except the one that is being forced. Maybe you are in the point of death, or you are at the point of being killed, and you are asked to say that you believe in Isa, in Jesus as a God, or you are asked to say anything that can nullify your Islam, or that can take you out from the fold of Islam. In which you are being forced, you have no authority, you have no power to defend yourself, you are being forced by people or by those in authority. Then, by this, if you should say that, if you should do any of this nullifier of Islam, then you've not gone out from the fold of Islam. You are still on Islam. But that is with conditions. The conditions are that one is that one should be forced. If you are being forced, you are not afraid, but you are being forced to do that. Not out of courtesy to the disbelievers, no, but you are being forced. Two is that while you are being forced, your heart should be rest assured in Islam. That is, you just say it out, any of the nullifiers of Islam, but your heart should be with Allah. You should have tranquility and certainty and rest assuredness about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your heart. And the third condition is that your intention should be that you want to defend or protect the forcefulness that is being pledged on you. So for you to remove this forcefulness, then you have to say it. It has to be free. Not because you want to please the one that is forcing you, or you want to please the disbelievers. No, but you want to remove yourself from the burden of that ikrar, of that being forced that is being placed on you. So once any of these are being done, then such a person is still in the fold of Islam. Because we came to understand during the first advent of Islam, and the first year and second year of Islam, where the Muslims are being tortured, are the weak Muslims, those that have no authority in society, when they are being tortured, the likes of Ammar ibn Yasir radiallahu ta'ala an, which led to a verse being revealed in Surah An-Nahl, verse 106. So when Ammar ibn Yasir, he became a Muslim, then he was being tortured by becoming a Muslim. So those in authority over Ammar ibn Yasir started punishing him that he should return back to his former religion, to his idol worshipping. And he was being punished. So they asked from him that he should disbelieve in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So after all this, and he should disbelieve in Muhammad. Instead of calling him Muhammad, the praised one, they asked from Ammar ibn Yasir that he should call him Mudhammam, the despised one. So, and he said it, not because he's been pleased with that, but he was being forced to say this. So after he said it, then he was being released. So now he has removed the burden on him. So he has been released from this burden. So he now went to Rasulullah and Abu Bakr. Then Rasulullah now asked him that, "Kayfa tajidu qalbak?" How did you find your heart? After you said all this, how is your heart? How is your heart? How are you now in faith? He said, "Mutma'innan bil iman." He said, I'm in tranquility that I have faith in Allah. I'm rest assured that I have faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now revealed the verse in Surah Al-Nahl, that is verse Quran chapter 16, verse 106, as you can see on your screen. Allah said, "Man kafara billahi min ba'di imani illa man ukriha wa qalbuhu mutma'innun bil iman walakin man sharaha bil kufri sadran fa 'alayhim ghadabun min Allah wa lahum 'adhabun 'adhim." Allah said that whosoever disbelieve in Allah, after his belief, except Allah now makes some exception, except the one that is being forced to disbelieve, but his heart is at rest with faith. He has faith in Allah, but he is being forced to disbelieve in Allah, but his heart is rest assured with iman. Allah said, "But such as open their breast to disbelief." So the one that his heart has been opened to disbelief, even as he is being forced, he still believe in that disbelief that he said. in such a person, Allah has prepared His anger and His wrath upon them, and for them is a great punishment. So as far as your faith is still on Iman, even if you have been forced to disbelieve in Allah, you should say it, you should disbelieve. But as far as your faith is still on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no blame on you on that. So that's what the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala is trying to explain to us. And the Shaykh says that وَكُلُّهَا مِنْ أَعْضَلِ مَا يَكُونُ خَطَرًا وَمِنْ أَكْثَرِ مَا يَكُونُ وُقُوعًا. As all these things that I've mentioned, that there are a lot of things that nullifies one's Islam, they are more than 100. But these things that the Shaykh mentioned here, they are the ones that people, they are 90% surety that people can fall into it. Things that are common in society, even during the Shaykh time. It is common, even in our own present time. So it is also common which people can fall into it. So this, that is why the Shaykh mentioned these 10 things, because they are the most common things. And they are the ones that one can easily fall into it. That's why the Shaykh mentioned this thing, and they are the most important one that we need to know as Muslims, because they are the most common and they are the easiest one that one can easily fall to. So the Shaykh now says, فَيَنْبَغِي لِلْمُسْلِمْ أَنْ يَحْذَرَهَا وَيَخَافُ مِنْهَا عَلَى نَفْسِهِ. It is compulsory for the Muslims to be wary of this. You should take caution while you are studying this for you not to fall into it, and you should be afraid of yourself not to fall into it. Because as far as someone is concerned, as far as a Muslim is concerned, he is afraid of falling into fitna, into trial. A Muslim is always afraid of falling into trial, no matter who you are, no matter how knowledgeable you are, how high you are in rank, or how high you are in faith in Allah, in Iman, in Taqwa. A Muslim will always be afraid of falling into fitna. As far as you are breathing, you are still alive, one can fall into temptation, into trial. May Allah save us from trial. So this is what the Shaykh is trying to explain to us, that we need to know all this so as to save ourselves from falling into the trial. Because if you look at our Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, when Prophet Ibrahim broke the old idols his people are worshipping, and because of that he was being thrown into the hellfire just because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet what did Ibrahim say? Ibrahim said, Allah said to us on the tongue of Ibrahim alayhi salam in Quran 14, Surah to Ibrahim, verse 35, that wa idh qala Ibrahim rabbi ij'al hadha al-balada aminan wajnubni wa baniya an na'bud al-asnam. And remember when Ibrahim said to us that, oh my Lord, make this city that is Mecca, make it one of peace and security, make it peace and security, and you should keep me and my sons and my offspring away from worshipping idols. Look at what Ibrahim said. That means one is exposed to fitna at any time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can expose one to fitna. Allah can change one from this Islam to other religions. Our hearts are between Allah's two fingers, in which Allah can change it anytime He wish. So this is what Ibrahim is saying to us. Ibrahim said again, رَبِّ إِنَّ هُدْنَ أَضْلَلْنَا كَثِيرًا مِنَ النَّاسِ. In the next verse, Ibrahim said that, verily, O my Lord, all these idols, all these things that they are worshipping, wallahi, they've indeed led astray many people among mankind. They've led many people among mankind astray. فَمَنْ تَبِعَنِي فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي. Whosoever follow me is part of me. So this is what Ibrahim is saying, trying to save himself from fitna. That indeed, no one can be saved from fitna except the one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has saved. We pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from falling into fitna. Amen. So the Shaykh now round it off by saying, نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ مُجِبَاتِ الْغَضَبِ. He prayed to Allah by saying, we seek refuge from Allah from things that will lead us to the anger of Allah, and from anything that will lead us to Allah's punishment. May Allah save us from them all. Ameen. وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ. And he sends salutation upon Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ, and upon his household, his companions, وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمْ. And he sends salutations upon us all, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from us as an act of worship. And may He, all what we've discussed from the beginning of this class to the end, may His infinite mercy make it as a means of our entry into His paradise. Ameen. And may forgive us all our shortcomings. Wa sallallahu wa sallam subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.